You'll go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Matthew 6. We're going to be looking at 6:12, Matthew 6:12 this morning. And many of you can say this from memory, from your heart. You know these words. And forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Again, I want to remind you, as I've reminded you a couple of times, these seem like pretty simple words as we just read through them, right? But there is so much there for us. And if we really understand what is there, we understand really what God is calling us to, as far as how we are to forgive others. And certainly we are going to be looking at that in depth here in just a few moments. And forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Let's pray. I pray, Father, that this morning you will help us to understand these verses more fully. We can plumb the depths of these verses. We know that, and we can continue to go with everything that they go for weeks and weeks and talk about the riches that we will find there. So this morning, Father, as we talk about a particular aspect of this prayer, I ask that, Father God, that you would open up hearts and minds. That you would open up hearts and minds, Father, for what you have for them this morning. As I preach this message on understanding our forgiveness that we have in you, and in so doing, understanding how we are to forgive others, I pray, Father, that you will do a work in all of our hearts. And if there are broken relationships in our midst because of a lack of forgiveness, that, Father, you will start to do a work of restoration and healing this morning. And maybe it's not families within our body here at Cross Life, but individuals here at Cross Life and in broken relationships with others. And at the root, again, is unforgiveness. I pray, Father, again, that your Spirit will do a work in our midst. I pray, Father, that you will help us to understand the depth of our forgiveness, how glorious it truly is, the breadth and the depth of our understanding, that it would be enlarged today as we understand truly what we have been forgiven of and the wrath we have been saved from. So, Father, be with us now, we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. Most of us, I believe, and I believe this is true because I've had a conversation about finances with many of you here. And I would say that most of us have a pretty good handle on our finances. And I would say that there's probably even some, well, I know there's some here that are even debt-free. I mean, you have taken Dave Ramsey to the extreme, and you're living a debt-free lifestyle, and praise God for that. So, but what if someone came up to you, and you're one of those people that are living debt-free to you, and they came up to you one day, and they had this really important document, and it had across the front of it, said paid in full, and they explained to you that, listen, I have this document here, and it's really good news. All of your debt is going to be completely paid in full. All you have to do is sign right here, and you're looking at them like, no, what? You don't understand. I have been through Dave Ramsey 10 times. All my debts are gone. I don't owe anyone anything. Well, sir or ma'am, I'm sorry, but actually, according to this, you took a loan out when you were 18 years old and you didn't pay it back. And since you didn't pay it back, interest has been accruing on that for the last 20 years, 30 years, 80 years, whatever. Okay, I don't think we have any 98-year-olds in here. Annette's not in here today. But it's been accruing. So you have a huge debt, and actually, you're not going to be able to pay this back. Look at this. It's going to take you a long time, but look, here's an act of grace on our behalf. We want to forgive that debt. All you have to do is sign this. That's it. No strings attached. We knew that this was a mistake that you made a long time ago, so here, just sign. Okay. Once you understand the bad news, once you understand the circumstances clearly, what are you going to do? You're going to take that pen in your hand and you're going to sign the bottom of that paper because you don't want to have that debt hanging over your head anymore, the debt that you didn't know about, but now you do. So you're going to sign the piece of paper and the debt is now free, is now been taken care of, paid in full. I think a lot of people, when we go to them, when we start talking about the good news of Jesus, that your sins can be forgiven, they can be paid in full, like a big stamp, paid in full. They kind of look at us bewildered, like, what are you talking about? My sins? I'm a pretty good person. I've done some things in my life that I'm not too proud of. I agree, that type of thing. But you're making it out to be much, much larger than it really is. You don't understand what kind of person I am. I'm basically good. So when we present the good news to someone without presenting the bad news, people aren't going to understand. They're not going to understand really the depth of their sin. They're not going to understand their real and true predicament before a righteous and holy God. And it's when we take the time to help them to understand their condition before that righteous and holy God, their sinful condition, the fact that God's wrath is going to be poured out upon them. When they understand that, when the scales have fallen and they can see for themselves clearly, then they will rejoice, because what you have just presented to them is truly good news. Our debt, we understand when Jesus is saying these words, our debt is sinfulness. Luke uses the word sin, hamartia, in his account of Jesus' prayer. And that's pretty much straightforward sin. Now that's actually, I'm not going to go there. There's female, male, and neuter. Hamartia is a female sin. I won't go there. I'm just kidding, okay? We know that males and females are sinners. So anyway, Luke uses the word hamartia in his account of Jesus' prayer. Forgive us of our sins. While Matthew here, in this account of this prayer, Matthew uses the word ophelima. Ophelima, which is a little different. Now, both are basically equal expressions, but ophelima comes with an additional nuance. And the nuance is this, that humans owe obedience to God. Sin creates an obligation or debt that we cannot possibly repay. It is beyond our ability. We can't repay it, no matter how many lifetimes we live, no matter how many good deeds we do, no matter how much money we give away. We cannot repay this debt that we owe God. This petition that we read here from Jesus, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors, it reminds us of where our forgiveness comes from. It is nothing that we have done in and of ourselves, for we can do nothing. It comes from Father, from our Father. Only He has the power to cancel the debt of our sins. And in understanding this, and understanding that Father is the one who can forgive our sins, and once He does forgive our sins, we are to be quick to forgive others. Now, we're going to return to that theme here in just a bit, but that's kind of the big picture, right? When we understand our sinfulness, when we understand the debt that we owe, when we understand that we could do nothing to save ourselves, but yet in His grace and His mercy sends His Son to die on the cross, to be beaten, brutally beaten, to die on the cross for our sins so that we can indeed be forgiven. When we understand that, when we understand how sinful we are and all of those are wiped clean, it then gives us the ability to turn to others who have sinned against us and forgive them. Luke 7, 41 through 43, and feel free to turn there if you like. We know this story well. Luke 7, 41, 43, and here's Jesus talking to Simon, the Pharisee that has just invited Jesus over for food and for conversation. And so Jesus says, "Simon, I have something to say to you." And Simon answered and said, "Say it, teacher." A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Now we understand this, right? This is a beautiful story, and we get it. We understand. Not all of Jesus' stories were as easily understood, right? Some of his parables you have to scratch your head over a little bit. But this was pretty clear. If I owe someone $10 and they come up to me and say, "Hey Todd, I gave you that $10 last night for that firewood, don't worry about it." Okay, thanks, man. I appreciate that. I'm going to be thankful, right? If they come up to me and say, hey, listen, you know, that $300,000 I gave you for it to buy your home, don't worry about it. It's yours, free and clear. I'm going to be really thankful, right? They might even get a Christmas gift for the next 50 years. I'm going to be super thankful. We understand this. For the one who's been given forgiven little, there will be a thankfulness, but not as much as the one who has been given forgiven much. We get this. But then I love the story that follows it. And this woman, we don't know a lot about her, but we do believe that she was a woman of the evening, a prostitute. And she comes forward to Jesus. And just imagine the courage that this woman had to begin with. Here's Jesus in the house of a Pharisee. Can you imagine how the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the religious leaders of that day, looked down upon this woman? But she didn't care. Jesus is in that house. I'm going to go be with Jesus. And so she goes into the house, and then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house, and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which have been many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. Those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. This woman understood clearly what Christ had just done for her. She understood clearly who he was and the fact that he had the ability, the authority, the power to forgive her sins. Forgive them completely. That's why we see this kind of attitude in her. Not one of, hey, Jesus, thanks, man. I appreciate that. That's really nice of you. No, she gets it. She is on her hands and her knees, and she is down, and she is washing his feet with her hair. She understands the debt that she owes this man who has forgiven her sins. And I don't think, I mean, we don't know anything more about her as far as the type of life she lived afterwards and how she interacted with people and what that looked like, but I can't imagine her leaving this home after this night, and if there were people in her life that had wronged her and the type of life that she lived, I'm sure there were a lot of people in her life that had wronged her. I can't imagine her leaving that after that experience, after having her sins forgiven in that way by Jesus himself, going out and holding a grudge. I can't imagine her going out and not being willing to freely forgive anyone who had ever done anything against her. Why? Because she understood the depth of her sin. She understood who she was, but she also understood who she now is in Christ. That her sins had been wiped clean. She had been forgiven. And so I want to address maybe a couple of different people that are in this today. Now, one, overall, for all of us, I want us to understand our sinfulness and understand what Christ has done, okay? But maybe you're not living in the fullness of your salvation. What do I mean by that? Well, I don't mean that you're not fully saved. If you are saved, you are fully saved, okay? There is no just little bit of salvation. If you have accepted the Lord Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, your sins have been wiped clean. You are fully saved. But what I mean by that is that you're not living in the fullness of your salvation. You're not experiencing the joy of your salvation because you're holding others' debts against them. You're like a payday loan where the interest just keeps accruing, and you can't forgive. There's two possible reasons for those who struggle with forgiving others. Now, there are more, but I think these are two of the more prevalent reasons that we see today for people who struggle in forgiving others. First one is, you don't believe that you're completely forgiven. You don't believe that you're completely forgiven once and for all. Again, it's kind of like Jesus plus whatever I can do. Or you feel like, well, you don't understand. You don't understand everything that I have done. You don't understand the life that I lived for 20 years. There is no way, you may not actually say this, but you believe it deep down. There is no way that Jesus' blood covers all of that. Now, Scripture makes it clear, it does. He covers everything. So it's not Jesus plus whatever you can do. It's you believing Jesus has done everything that needed to be done, period. Is you believing these two simple but incredibly important verses, Romans 5:1 and 8:1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You are at peace. Why? Because your sins have been completely forgiven. And there's a problem if you don't believe that they're completely forgiven because you don't believe that you are at complete peace with God. But you are. And I love Romans 8:1. I actually had this verse at a funeral I was at one time, and this was his life verse. I don't think it's my life verse. I think I have too many verses. I don't know if I can have a life verse, but I love this one. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Those are really simple words, aren't they? So simple, but so powerful. I want you to hear me say these words again, and I want you to understand that this is what Jesus is saying about you. This is what Paul is saying about you, you who are in Christ Jesus. This is what he says about you. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Do you understand that? That is you. If you're in Christ, he's not sitting up there thinking, yeah, most of their sins are cleansed, but this one over here, this recurring one that they have, there's just really nothing we could do about that one. They're going to see what they can do on their own. No. It's done. It's over. It's gone. Now live in the joy of that understanding. Live in the joy of that understanding that you are completely forgiven and that when he looks at you, again, he doesn't see someone that's partially clean. He sees someone that has been completely clean, completely washed by the blood of Jesus, and he sees a saint standing in white. A white, a brilliant white, beyond anything we can fathom or imagine. He sees us that way. Why? Because he sees us through the lens of his Son. And through that lens of that Son, it says, completely paid. Paid in full. Whatever you want to say, your sins are forgiven. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So when you don't understand the extent of the grace that has been shown to you, it is impossible to extend that same kind of grace to others. Does that make sense? When you don't really understand the grace that's been shown to you, it is impossible to in turn extend that same grace to others. Now, we're imperfect, and we cannot extend the same grace that God has extended us because he is perfect. He completely covers everything we have done. We understand that. But in our imperfections, we can still forgive. And we need to understand that, brothers and sisters. And the second reason is this. Maybe you don't understand the depth of your sin. So the first is on one side, right? You understand your sin fully. You understand it so well that you believe that there's no way that Jesus can completely wipe them away. And I'm here to say that he has. And he can, if they have not been. If you're here today and your sins have not been wiped clean, today is the day where they can be completely washed clean. By repenting of your sins and turning to him, saying, Lord Jesus, forgive me for my sins and I want to follow you today. But then again, the flip side of this, that is, maybe you don't understand the depth of your sins. I'm really thankful for Jesus dying for my sins. I really appreciate that. That was awful nice of him. But, you know, honestly, I'm not that bad of a guy. I'm really not that bad of a guy. If you look at me and Joe over here, I'm pretty good. There's no Joe over here, is there? No, okay, all right. But we set up this this balance system where we balance our goodness against another fallen human being's goodness. And when we do that, we don't understand our sin. We need to measure our sin against a holy and righteous God. When we start to understand that, we start to understand a little more fully our sinfulness. And we have to get away from this, I'm really not that bad of a guy. You are. You are that bad of a guy. You are that bad of a gal. Let's just understand that. We are all sinners, okay? Now you understand what I mean by that, right? When we understand our sinfulness fully, when we understand the heinousness of our sin, when we understand how God views our sin and not how we tend to view our sin, which isn't that bad usually, when we start to view it correctly, then we start to understand the debt that we owe. Then we start to understand, truly understand what Jesus did for us. And that should give us a clue, right? Right there, that our sin is pretty bad. That Jesus had to come from glory to live here on this earth for 33 odd years. He had to leave the side of His Father to come here to live with us, sinful human beings, and to what? Die for our sins. That should give us an inkling as to how bad our sin was for what He went through on our behalf. So maybe you don't understand the depth of your sin. I hope that by God's grace, He peels back the layers and he helps you to start understand how significant all of our sin is. Again, when you don't see your sin for what it is, when you compare your sin to others and not to a righteous and holy God, then you will not be as thankful and your perspective will be skewed. You'll be just like the guy here that Jesus talks about that a little bit was given forgiven. Will they be a little thankful? Yes. But what about the one that was forgiven a lot? Yes. They will be incredibly thankful. They will be like the woman on her hands and knees washing His feet because we understand the depth of our sin. And for those of us who are in Christ, we understand, hopefully, what we have been forgiven from. But there are a handful in here, and I know this is the case. I know this is true because this is just humanity, that we oftentimes don't see our sin for what it truly is. I encourage you today to ask the Lord to show you so that indeed you can be as thankful as He calls us to be for Him doing what He has done for us. There's another parable that Jesus gives, and this is a sobering one. It's from Matthew 18, 23 through 25. I'm sorry, I'm in Luke. Let me go back to Matthew. Matthew 18, 23 through 25. Peter, let me give a little backdrop here because Peter is talking to Jesus and Peter came up and said to Him, "Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you seven times, but 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now that's millions and millions of dollars. Let's understand that. It was far beyond anything he could repay in that time, in his lifetime. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payments to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, I have patience with me, and I will pay you everything," which of course was a foolish statement because he could not. It was beyond anything he could pay. "And out of pity for him, the master of the servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when the same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, 'Pay what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, I will pay you.' He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw that what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. You should, and should not you have mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. I don't know about you, but these are some sobering, sobering words. Do you understand the point of what he is saying here? That this man's greatest sin was he wasn't thankful. He didn't truly understand what the king had done for him. He didn't understand truly the debt that was forgiven. And so since he didn't truly understand the debt that was forgiven or took it for granted, what did he do? He went to the one who owed him 100 denarii and said, "Give me the money." And when he didn't give it to him, he had him thrown in jail. Brothers and sisters, we are like this. If we have been forgiven of our sins, this debt that this man in 100 lifetimes, actually it's not 100 lifetimes, I actually read something and it was multiple lifetimes that this man would have to live if he was making like a minimum wage today. It was multiple lifetimes that he would have had to have lived to pay this back. In other words, he couldn't. It was beyond his ability to pay this back. Yet he was forgiven, but he would not forgive. Brothers and sisters, in our sinfulness, it is beyond our ability to pay it back. We need to understand this. There is nothing that we can do in and of ourselves. It is beyond our ability. Yet it has been paid in full. And what do we do, some of us? We hold things against others. Well, you don't understand what they did to me. You don't understand how bad it was. You don't understand what they did to my family. You don't understand what they said about me. You don't understand. You fill in the blank, because we're really good at making up these things, right? Of coming up with a lot of different reasons to hold things against other people. But Jesus says, no, there is no reason. There is zero reason to hold something against another when you, as a follower of Jesus, understand what you have been forgiven of. I hope that's sinking in. I hope you're understanding this. Because there are very few things that make us more bitter, more tied up inside, shackle us more than bitterness. And bitterness comes from unforgiveness. We know this, right? When we do not forgive another, they may or may not know it. Who is it damaging? It's damaging us. Because that unforgiveness turns in on us and it turns into bitterness. That unforgiveness turns in on us and it shackles us. That unforgiveness turns in on us and we are not able to enjoy the freedom that we have in Christ. The freedom from our sins that we have in Christ. We are not able to understand the love that we have in Christ. The freedom that we have in Christ. Because we have shackled ourselves. There's a quote by, let me back up a little bit. Actually, I'll say this. It's Paul David Tripp. Renee sent this quote to me. It's a great quote. He says, "Our Redeemer not only convicts, he forgives. He not only forgives, but he delivers. He not only delivers, but he restores." I think sometimes some of us get to the delivered part, the forgiven part and the delivered part. We know that we have been delivered from our sins, but then we kind of stop before that whole restoration part. He desires to restore us. He desires to restore us completely in relationship with Him. And while he's done his part, there's also a part in that that is up to us. We are to understand that forgiveness that is ours. We are to pursue him in relationship. We are to have a right understanding of who we are in him, all of those types of things. But he desires also to restore us in relationship with others. And when we do not forgive, it keeps those relationships from being restored. There is absolutely no way a relationship can be restored in a way that is honoring to Christ if someone has not been forgiven in that relationship. It's impossible. He starts this out, and I love it, this whole passage here in Matthew 18 with, therefore the kingdom of heaven may be compared to. And then he talks about the forgiveness that the king gives. And in showing the attitude that this man had, he shows the opposite attitude that one should have who has been forgiven by the king. But I love it because what is a heart issue, right? It's always a heart issue in the kingdom of God. It's always a heart issue. It always comes back to our heart. Do we truly believe the truth? Have we bought into lies? Do we understand our forgiveness? Are we forgiving others? It's always a heart issue. And it's no different in this. The kingdom of heaven is like this. And it takes us back to the beginning of the prayer that we started a few weeks ago. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. For that aspect of his kingdom to be manifest here on this planet, this aspect of God's forgiveness, this aspect of no matter what you have done, God's grace, God's forgiveness can cover all. He desires for us to manifest it in our lives so that an unbelieving world can see what it looks like to serve a forgiving God. Because when we say that we have been forgiven of our sins, yet we hold to things that people have done to us and we refuse to forgive, what kind of testimony is that to those around us? What kind of witness are we being to those around us? Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Part of that will in his kingdom is for his subjects, us, his sons and daughters in the kingdom of God, to manifest his grace to those around us. That's why it's so important for us to understand our forgiveness in him and then extend it to others. God's rule, God's righteousness, his love is to be manifest through us when we truly understand the depth of our sin and we understand that sin was indeed nailed to the cross with Jesus saying, paid in full across it. It makes possible, not easy. And understand when I say this. Forgiveness is not easy. Because we have been born again, because we have been redeemed and we are a new creation, it does not automatically follow that, woof, well, I don't care what happened to me, I can forgive. It's so easy now. No. There's some really hard things that happen to us in this life. And just because we are called to forgive doesn't make that forgiveness an easy thing to do. That's why we call on God to give us the strength to forgive, to remind us of the gospel, to remind us of what we've been forgiven of, so that indeed we can forgive, no matter the sin. We've all heard stories of these things, right? Where people have been, you know, certain crimes committed against them, committed against their family, you know, a DUI, guy's drunk, he kills a young girl, young teenage girl. And after the family forgives this young man, believers, they forgive this young man, they start a relationship with him when he is in jail. This is true. When he comes out of jail, they actually bring him into their home so that they can love him, so that he can be restored in relationship with them, but primarily, hopefully, restored in relationship with God, because he was not a believer when all this happened. That's forgiveness. That's love. That's hard. Another story, and there's a lot of them out there. Well, we know Charleston, right? Our brothers and sisters are sitting there at a Bible study on a Wednesday night, and a guy comes in, is having a study with them, and then pulls out a gun and kills half of them. And what did we see over and over? What did we hear during the trial? Is these people, the family members of the ones who were killed, standing up saying, listen, because of what I have been forgiven of, I forgive you. That's forgiveness. And that's hard. But it's what we are called to do. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Jesus helps us to remember our forgiveness. And as a reminder of how absolutely vital it is to forgive others. Understanding that we are not God, we understand that. And the forgiveness we extend to others is not perfect like the forgiveness that He extends to us. I want you to ask this question of yourself. And this is a hard question because I asked myself this question this week and it's hard. If Jesus were to forgive me in the same way and measure that I forgive those who sin against me, what would that forgiveness look like? That's a hard question, isn't it? Now again, I understand that we forgive imperfectly. But I think there are many of us that can forgive better than we have. That we can manifest the love of Jesus better in some of the relationships that we have and the way that we extend forgiveness to other people. That's a hard question, isn't it? That's one of those whole the whole spiritual gut check type things. That is it, man. That'll knock the air out of you. If Jesus were to forgive me in the same way and measure that I forgive those who sin against me, what would that forgiveness look like? I remember this. When we forgive, it not only frees us to live and the joy of our own forgiveness and salvation. It does that, doesn't it? It releases us to live in the joy and freedom of our own salvation. But it is also evidence to the world that our forgiveness is not just words. Can you imagine if the family members of those who were killed in that church in Charleston, if they had stood up and said, I know I'm forgiven by Jesus, but that man does not deserve forgiveness. What he did was so heinous. What he did was so hurtful. What he did destroyed our family, and I am not forgiving that man. Can you imagine what kind of testimony that would have been to an unbelieving world? But they stood up and they said, because I understand what I have been forgiven from and of, and my sins have been wiped clean, I can extend forgiveness to this young man who has taken so much from me, who has hurt my family so much, but I forgive him. That's the kind of testimony that we need to be to an unbelieving world. So it's not just words that we speak, but we are living it through our actions and our words. Because at the very beginning, at foundationally to all of this, we can be forgiven. We can forgive, rather. We can forgive because we have been forgiven.